blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. It's perfect submission, purchased in blood, visions of rapture now burst on my side. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his majesty, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day.
soul, thou Savior dear. It is not night if thou be near. O may no earth-born cloud arise to hide thee from thy servant's eyes. When the soft dews of kindly sleep, my wearied eyelids gently steep, be my last thought how sweet to rest forever on my Savior's breast. Abide with me from morn till eve, for without thee I cannot live. Master, let me walk with thee in lowly paths of service free. Tell me thy Savior, help me bear the strain of toil, the fret of care. Help me thus, Lord. on life's billows you are tempest tossed. When you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Count your many blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy? Blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your many blessings, name them one.
Let's pray. Dear God, we're thankful to you that we can be together today in this gathering, this congregation of family, of believers, of friends, and loved ones. And we pray your blessings upon us as we spend our time today in your presence, gathered around your feet. We come to you looking for encouragement. We come with our hearts filled with a mixture of hope and sorrow. We ask that through this service, you might help us to honor our sister, Sharon Olson, and that we might also bring honor and glory to your name for the many good things that you have brought to us, especially through Sharon and her family and all of those associated with her life. Be with all of us that participate in today's service and help us as we share. And be with everyone. Give us comfort. Help us as we shed tears. Help us to also remember and celebrate and enjoy so many good things for which we are thankful. And in all of these things, we lift up our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Just want to mention that following the service, lunch will be served in the building here immediately after the service, and everyone is welcome to stay, and we'll give you some direction as to how to move from where you're seated to where the lunch is. The family is going to go to a brief interment at the Hillcrest Cemetery, and then they'll come back and join us during the lunch. The family has selected a number of hymns, people to lead prayer, a number of scriptures that they will share with us. And so I encourage you to turn your heart towards God as we reach out to Him with our voices and with our hearts, and we look to Him for encouragement today. You have a song folder that'll be in your, that was handed to you when you came in. The songs aren't necessarily in the order that's there. The first song will be Sing the Wondrous Love of Jesus. And the brothers of Sharon are leading singing during our service today, and so we'll call on Wilf to come and lead our first song.
When we all get to heaven, sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
I also want to thank those who, and there are many who have been in touch with us and are participating, viewing in today's service from online, and we thank you for joining us as well, and thanks to all of you who have traveled, some I see from a distance, to be here today. The family appreciates your love and support. At this time, we're going to call on Kathy and Marjorie, two of Sharon's sisters, to come and share the eulogy.
Sharon Louise Olson was born on the 10th of May, 1962, in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, and died on the 5th of August, 2022, at the Pasqua Hospital in Regina, Saskatchewan, at the age of 60 years, due to brain and bone metastasis from breast cancer. She is survived by her parents, Roland and Lois Olson of North Weyburn, her siblings, Kathy Olson and Vern Castle, Wilfred and Laura Olson, Marjorie Olson and Jeremy Mather, Bernard and Debbie Olson, Conrad and Daphne Olson, Stephanie and Dan Canfield. Sharon is also survived by her 17 nieces and nephews and 13 plus one great nieces and nephews. She was predeceased by her maternal grandparents, Wilfred and Pearl Orr, by her paternal grandparents, Robert and Martha Olson, and her brother-in-law, Walter Ridgway. We also want to mention our uncles, Ken Olson, Raymond Orr, and Roger Olson. Sharon was the fifth of seven blonde children, but her hair was so blonde it was almost white. Imagine Mom's outrage when someone suggested that Sharon's hair was bleached to be that blonde. One day when we were out playing, Mom noticed that although Sharon had gotten up from her nap, she was nowhere to be found and a large search ensued. It turned out that Sharon had still been tired and crawled into the corner of her crib and gone back to sleep, innocently unaware of the fuss going on.
A few years later, Mom and Dad took us in the Shasta trailer to Lloydminster, where there was a singing school being put on by the congregation there. We learned to sing with shaped notes at an early age, and this was the beginning. While camping in Lloydminster, Sharon ran by the wood-burning stove in the picnic shelter and burned her upper arm, leaving a scar that stayed for the rest of her life. Sharon was as competitive as her brothers and sisters. And when Wilf and Bernard went across a busy intersection to buy a birthday gift for a friend, 3-year-old Sharon decided to tag along. She quickly got behind and slipped on the snow and ice, ending up with her arms in the gutter under a city bus. The bus driver couldn't see her, but other drivers could, and honking horns caused the bus to stop. Terrified brothers ran home to get Mom and Dad, who held her in the back of the police car as she was rushed to the hospital, where she spent a week. Although she suffered a broken collarbone, and her hands were imprinted with the knit of her mittens, she was relatively unscathed.
After attending Haltane School in Saskatoon, Sharon moved with her family to North Weyburn, where her father taught at Western Christian College and her mom worked in the lab at the Weyburn Union Hospital. While Kathy walked down the street to go to school, the rest of the siblings rode the school bus into Weyburn every day, Wilf to the junior high and the rest to Elgin School. Eventually, Sharon also attended Western for grades 9 through 12, graduating in 1980 and a year of junior college before moving to Saskatoon to attend the university. After 2 years at university, Sharon took a break to work with the church in Geneva, Switzerland, where she solidified her mastery of the French language. She returned to Saskatoon, where she completed her degree in education. Sharon taught at Pleasant Dale Elementary School in Estevan for 4 years, during which she kicked her nephew Jeremy out of class for helping a cute little girl with answers for an assignment. From Estevan, Sharon moved to Dauphin, where she taught at the relocated Western Christian College from 1991 to 1994. It was while she was in Dauphin that she started to understand that apples, onions, garlic, vegetables, salad were not her friend, and that led to a lifelong study of food issues. After teaching in Dauphin, Sharon returned to university to upgrade her education, after which she moved to Caernport to teach at the elementary school. For 21 years, she taught core French and grades 3 through 8 with supportive fellow staff members. She bought a house in Caernport, and it was home for many years while she worshipped with the Church of Christ in Moose Jaw, making many lifelong friends who were wonderful supports.
In 2017, Sharon was diagnosed with breast cancer, and as it was no longer possible to teach due to treatment, she went on sick leave. Chemotherapy, radiation, and surgery took their toll, and in June 2020, she officially retired as a teacher. In total, Sharon was a teacher for 28 years, although she never stopped teaching and learning. During her sick leave and retirement, Sharon painted and painted. She took inspiration from the satellite photos of the South Saskatchewan River on Google Maps and followed the flow past green fields and white sandbars. She hoped to supplement her pension income by selling paintings and set up a website and special Facebook profile to promote her work. Online classes for marketing of her work and art classes provided by the University of Saskatchewan occupied hours a week as she learned new skills and techniques. When you wondered what the light was next to the moon, Sharon knew which planet you saw. She bought a telescope so she could see further into space and find what other astronomers had discovered.
She had an amazing memory for genealogy and could keep track of the generations when John married Mary, and they had two children, John and Mary, and John married Mary and Mary married John. Sharon made connections with others in our families whose interest in genealogy equaled her own. She loved to ski, travel, and watch tennis. Sunshine Village was an annual trip with her sister Kathy and nieces Christine, Karen, and Patricia. She even went to Switzerland with Conrad to ski when he was at university in Leuven, Belgium. And don't you dare tell her the scores of the tennis if she hasn't watched her recording. I asked her who her favorite tennis player was, but she wouldn't answer. But we know she liked Roger Federer and Rafael Nadal. She traveled to France and attended the French Open in Paris with Conrad, a dream come true. As a gift for her 60th birthday, Wilf collected money from her siblings and nibblings to send her to France to go to the French Open or the Monaco Masters. She was overwhelmed with the gift and so excited to plan a trip. Sharon sang. She sang with the chorus in Western and the University of Saskatchewan Greystone Singers for 3 years. She joined a choir in Estevan and another in Dauphin and sang in church her whole life. Many have commented on how her voice added so much to any occasion. Sharon supported several causes. True North Helping Hands combined travel with education and helping, as she traveled with Patty Kunkel for several years to northern Mexico to build schoolrooms in small, underserved communities. She knew what needed to be done and how it needed to be done, and if she couldn't do it herself, she could instruct someone and get the job done. She felt that these schoolrooms made a difference for the children and the whole community. After her breast cancer diagnosis, Sharon became an advocate, encouraging governments to allow earlier screening and detection of breast cancer in earlier stages. She was concerned that women didn't know the heightened risk associated with breast density, as she herself didn't understand that a mammogram might not see cancer in dense breast tissue. The Canadian Task Force, none of whom are breast cancer specialists or radiologists, based testing criteria on a flawed study, which led to many jurisdictions not allowing screening of women between 40 and 50 years, even if they had a family history of breast cancer. With the encouragement of Jenny Dale and Dense Breast Canada, Sharon presented to the Saskatchewan Ministry of Health to allow younger women to be tested. And Sharon loved her nieces and nephews, considering what to choose for Christmas gifts. Everyone got a small Swiss Army pocket knife, you know, the ones with the scissors, and a thermos travel mug that kept your coffee too hot to drink until you reached your destination. For the last few years, each niece and nephew, nibblings for the uninitiated, received a miniature painting of the North Saskatchewan River from space. Siblings received larger paintings and they hang in our home with pride. Her painting studio has many untouched canvases. She had more work to be done.
After contracting COVID in March of 2022, Sharon started to have symptoms of long COVID, including dizziness, facial numbness, and extreme fatigue. In addition, she suffered from extreme back and hip pain. Doing anything became a struggle, and she relied on help from mom and dad for day-to-day chores. When the back pain became too much to bear, her doctor in Moose Jaw insisted that she go to emergency at the Regina General Hospital to investigate the pain. After 48 hours, she was finally moved to the neurosciences unit, where she met with neurologists, pain medicine specialists, urologists, and neurology surgeons. Being in a double room affords very little privacy, but Sharon got to know her roommate, Shelley, and they were able to share feelings and information. It was good for Sharon to have someone so close to her in age and experience. Many tests were performed. Scans were painful, as lying on a hard scan bed was difficult because of her back. Finally, just in case, the neurosurgeon, Dr. Utara, sent her for a scan of her head. He expressed surprise when he came to tell us about the scan, in which it was obvious that there was a large tumor in her front parietal lobe. Sharon, of course, wanted to see the scan, and the fine doctor took us to the screen where he zoomed through the layers of the scan, and there it was, obvious even to the untrained eye. Surgery was indicated, and the doctor went about trying to book a time as soon as possible.
After a brief time of mourning, Sharon began to think of the next steps and arranged with her cousin lawyer, Ruth, to prepare her last will and testament and assigning power of attorney. She made lists of what would need to be done so she could go home and ways that those who offered could help. Although the original surgeon was not available the week after the diagnosis, Dr. Dalkalik was able to take her case and quickly book the OR for the surgery on June 28th. After surgery, she spent extra time in ICU because of the lack of the beds in the neuro unit. She was waited on hand and foot by her special nurses. Recovery from the surgery was quick and complete, although walking was difficult and none of the issues with her back were resolved. Sharon moved to the Pasqua Hospital and the Alan Blair Cancer Center, where the cancer treatment was offered. With Kathy and Vern available to provide medical interpretations, a family meeting July 28th was held with her original oncologist, Dr. Dalada. We were told that because Sharon was still experiencing issues with her mobility, it was evident that the cancer had spread beyond the tumor into the lining around the brain and spinal column. Radiation and chemotherapy would not be helpful, and we needed to think of end-of-life care. This was shocking news to all of us. That evening, after I arrived, and with Sharon's full participation, a review of the goals of care with her nurse, Dean, was completed. Since no treatment for cancer was available, a move to palliative care, where only one doctor would be required to change medications to reflect Sharon's level of pain, made the process more flexible and seamless. In the palliative care unit, Sharon enjoyed a large room where many family members could gather. Her nurse, Maria, was able to make suggestions to improve Sharon's last days. Getting out of bed became a Herculean task involving a lift and a special reclining chair. Although she was only able to get up a couple of times, it allowed us to take her to the art gallery and briefly outside, where she joined us with the laugh.
For many days, Sharon's face would light up with a smile when someone new came to visit or when Mom and Dad arrived to sit with her. She was not left alone day or night through her stay in palliative care. As time passed, she became more and more unresponsive. But the day her brother Conrad arrived from France, she woke up and gave the best smile ever. Sharon shared that smile a couple more times, but the next day was almost totally unresponsive after that, except when Marge opened a chocolate bar in her hearing.
Every day, Sharon's breathing became slower and slower, and with longer and longer breaks between. The last day, her breathing was rapid as her body gave up. Her family gathered and said goodbye because we knew that time was short. She left us with her mom and her dad, with me and my husband, Jeremy, at her side. We sang hymns and held her, telling her she was in God's hands and she didn't have to worry about those left behind. What a blessing to have so many siblings so that special care and attention could be lavished on Sharon during the difficult last months. So many of Sharon's nieces and nephews and great-nieces and great-nephews were able to visit while Sharon was in the hospital. She was grateful for every visit. Thank you so much for making her life brighter. To many members of Sharon's community who supported her during her illness, provided cheer and encouragement, for those who volunteered to share in her care, for meals and flowers, our hearts are full. Thank you.
Come on.
Thank you for that very loving tribute and your presentation of it. One of the things that is a blessing about today is the coming together of family. Sharon was blessed to be surrounded with a wonderful family, and those of us who are also related or who are brothers and sisters in Christ, friends and neighbors associated with Sharon in some way over the years, we feel really blessed to know Sharon's family, and we feel very honored to have you here today and for us to be with you. And we pray that we can be an encouragement to you. We're going to call on another one of Sharon's brothers now to come and lead us in a song. So if you would find the song, How Great Thou Art, Bernard will come and lead us.
Oh, Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, when through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is Son not sparing, send him to die, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, be blessed God to take away my sin. Then sing my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, how great thou art, how great thou art. sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
How great thou art,
how great thou art. Let's just hum the chorus and think of Sharon singing. Then sings my soul.
I was hoping John would get up and say, yeah, now her brother Lowell, because we are brothers in the Lord, which is the best kind of family. There was hardly a time in our lives that Darla and I did not know Sharon. Even in Europe, Sharon and Darla shared many special times. She is our dear friend and sister. She's a great part of the church family here in Weyburn. Sharon was tender and compassionate. Once in our youth group, I remember a special moment when she shed a few tears and we shared tears together as she was dealing with a loss. Sharon was amazing at supporting our church family. She would faithfully attend when she could. She would always was reaching out to new members and making new friends with people who attended. Her messenger app and texting page were always in overdrive, even in the last days of her life. Sharon was generous. She was really generous. I loved her 1998 Acura, and I'd say, how's my car? And one day she said, Lowell, I have the car ready for the girls. And in one weekend, she fell in love with another Acura, a new one. And it was time to clear the driveway. Later, I found all the receipts from the repairs she had done to the car to have it ready for the girls. After all, our girls were her girls. I recommend you look on Facebook and read Brooke's post about life with Sharon, the important and sometimes overlooked mentoring of young women by older women was practiced by Sharon. And many young women and Christians benefited from her teaching, example, dedication to God and the church. Sharon was generous and giving in every congregation she was a part of. But the Weyburn Church family was always her home, we felt. She came for summers, holidays, and special events. We could count on her to help anytime there was a VBS, a Harvest Fellowship, a fundraiser, or a barbecue. Sharon was there to help out. We could always count on her to help. She was an amazing Bible student, loved having her in Bible class. Her knowledge of scripture and ability to reference passages was a great asset, and no one used an iPad to look up a passage quicker than Sharon. She knew so many songs, and I'll miss having her join me in the melody and perhaps start a song that I'm having difficulty getting started. Happened many a times. There's a big hole in this church family, and we'll miss her so much. Can you pray with me, please? Let's draw on the Lord for comfort. God, give us comfort in our loneliness and sadness for our dear sister Sharon. We are forever impacted by her memory and her example. As we think about how you, Lord, used her in so many ways, so many lives for so many years. God, we thank you for the blessing of knowing Sharon and her family. God, send us your peace. Help us to have open hearts to the great comforter, your Spirit. And as we read these words of Scripture today from your Holy Bible, help us to see your plan of salvation and increase in our hope, the hope with victory that Sharon displayed. Bless us as we remember today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Isaiah 53. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned all to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
He was oppressed, he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbed with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and many and made intercession for the transgressors.
So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory.
Amen.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and righteousness. I dare not trust his holiest name, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness dies his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant, his blood. Support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
I want to say thank you to Sharon's sisters, Kathy, Marjorie, and Stephanie, for reading our scriptures for us today, and also for Sharon's brothers, including Conrad, who just led us in a song. Thank you for leading the hymns today. I know that probably was not the easiest of things to do, but it made it very special for us to hear you share those words of scripture and to hear you lead those hymns and for us to join with you. And we join with you in cherishing Sharon and the faith that she had, the things she believes in, and we experience a lot of peace by being able to hear those scriptures. When I was at Roland and Lois's earlier this week, we talked about Isaiah 53 and how Sharon loved that passage of scripture because it was about Jesus. Jesus who came to be sacrificed for sin and to end our suffering. But the real fulfillment of his purpose, and this is something that Lois wanted us to think about today, was in his resurrection. He came to die on the cross to remove our sins, but he came to rise from the tomb triumphant so that we might have everlasting life. And so we want to remember that today. And so the other scripture that we read is one that we remembered from Colossians. So in the spirit of Sharon being a teacher, I brought flashcards. They're flashcards for me, not so much for you, but I want you to maybe create your own set of flashcards, at least in your mind. What I did with these flashcards is I thought, I'm going to put on each card a part of life that was a favorite experience, something that Sharon loved to do. And what I want us to think about is not just the things we know that Sharon loved to do and to collect all those things and put them all in like a file box, but what I want us to remember, and as we touch base with some of these things, as you've seen a lot of pictures, as you heard her sisters read her eulogy and gave their beautiful tribute, we shared with Sharon a lot of these things. Sharon didn't just have a rich and full life because of her faith and because of the kind of person that she was and the interests that she took in, but she shared those things with us. And those are the things that we'll remember. And so I just want to go through and I'm just going to kind of randomly shuffle my flashcards here. and remember some of the experiences of Sharon. Languages, okay, is one that I wrote I had to write a flashcard about languages. She taught French, that was mentioned, but she loved languages in general. She tried to learn languages wherever she traveled. When we were doing mission work in Mexico, she wanted to try and speak Spanish, and she did learn a little bit of Spanish. She was always intrigued with languages. And as the minister here at the church in Weyburn, I loved it that whenever I tried to dabble in the New Testament languages, not everybody is always impressed with that. Sometimes they would just say, you know, just stick to English, please. And but Sharon always appreciated the study and the background study that we would do to delve into the original languages and the richness of what that revealed. She loved languages. And that's something we shared, and many of you shared with her. If you started speaking with her in French, she would brighten right up and have a conversation with you with a big smile on her face, because she loved that. She loved languages. World travel. It's mentioned about some of her world travels, and I'm not going to go over all of those things, but she was always interested in different cultures and interesting places. I don't know how many conversations I've had with her where she's told me stories about Geneva, and I told her stories about Belgium. And, you know, a lot of people like to travel, but again, Sharon, that was something that she was always sharing with us, right? It's not just something that she was not just a hermit that traveled around the world and disappeared for several years and came back and we didn't know where she was or what she was doing. No, she shared her love of travel and her love of adventures and going places with us. This was a shared experiences. Art and painting, and even pottery and other artful things, photography. She had a lot of hobbies that were related to art, and she loved those things, but she shared them, and pulled other people in, as was mentioned. She was wanting to teach and share her art with other people, and she was very committed to that. Sharon loved history. Sharon loved current events. I'm just going through my cards. Sharon loved astronomy. Sharon loved gardening. Sharon loved education, you know, experimenting, acquiring new skills, teaching, learning. Sharon was interested in health, fitness, diet, singing, family ancestry. You know, every now and then I try and sit down and talk to people about my family heritage. You know, I'm descendant from William Brewster, like many of you are. I share that heritage with you. But there's not many of you that are very interested when I sit down and try to tell you about that. Maybe it's because you don't really want to be related to me. I'm not sure why that is. But Sharon took special interest in that. Anyways, I don't know what cards you have in your little file book. I just turned to the next one. It said missions, True North Helping Hands. That was something that I was able to share with Sharon. In 2007 was the first year that I went, and I didn't know who all was going, and I was really quite pleased and surprised at the same time to see that Sharon was there. Well, I think Roland and Lois ended up going a bunch of times, and some of the rest of the family, and I don't know that we would have all gone as many times as we did, except that Sharon kept going. And it wasn't just those of her family. She had her three amigos that she was friends with, and they were a special feature. I guess one thing I'll always remember is that the first year that we were there, she just about perished from sunstroke. And so from then on, she became I guess you'd call it the officer in charge of, sunstroke prevention. She would be constantly reminding us, are you drinking your water? Where's your hat? You know, have you put sunscreen on? There's refreshments in the station. Go get some fruit. And she was always after us about those things. Well, think about your flashcards and the file box that you would fill up. And I'm sure many of you would, like me, would fill up a file box with flashcards of experiences that you've had, that you've shared with Sharon. She was that kind of person, and I don't know if it was I don't know if it was because of her what's the right way to say this, because of her singleness, that she had the freedom to travel and go and go to lots of places and be with lots of people. But that's what she loved to do, and that's what she did. And of all the hobbies and interests and many things that she was interested in, they were not just private interests. They were always things that she shared with us. And that was very wonderful. That's why we're going to miss Sharon. You know, if I go on another True North Helping Hands trip, it's not going to be the same without Sharon. It's going to be a while when we sing certain songs, like some of the songs we've been singing today, where I'm going to be listening for that voice, for Sharon's voice, and I'm going to be missing her, because she shared so much with us. Sharon loved her Lord, and she loved the Scriptures, the Word of God. And so one of the things that she shared with many of us is that she was baptized into Christ at a young age. And I sometimes talked about that with her. I was 10 years old, and I'm not sure how old Sharon was. I tried to get that out of her family, and they weren't sure. She was young, though. She was pre-adult, I think, when she was baptized. And so there's a scripture that I wanted to touch base with. It's from Romans chapter 6, which talks a lot about baptism, verses 3 through 11. I'm not going to read all of it, but I want to read some of it. Because, and here's something that I did talk about with some of the family the other day. It's never enough. You know, I think about 60 years of life, and that's not enough. You know, I think about 25 years ago, I did a funeral for a little girl who only lived 14 days. That's not enough. But I've known people who have lived to be 100 years old. That's not enough. I find it intriguing when we read through the scriptures and some of the patriarchs who lived for hundreds of years, some of them over 900 years. And sometimes I think, well, that would be enough. But God didn't think so. That's not enough. He created us for eternity. He sent Jesus Christ to this earth to die on the cross because 60 years isn't enough. And he wanted us to be united with Jesus in his death, as Romans 6 talks about, so that one day we would be united with him in his resurrection, never to die again. I just want to read some of the verses from that passage. Verse 4 from Romans 6. Therefore, we were buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we also might walk in newness of life. We all rejoice in the shared experience of putting to death our old self by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Verses 6 and 7. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, so that we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But the best experience of all to share with each other and with Sharon is to be united in a resurrection like that of Jesus Christ. Verse 5, for if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. For some of us, waking up each day is like raising the dead. You know how it is. You know, I don't function that well before noon. Once I'm awake, I'm awake. And I don't know what it was like to wake up Sharon. Maybe some of you who, you know, lived with her all her life know what that was like. But regardless of how well any of us have slept, and regardless of how well we've how awake and alive we've been throughout the day, the time comes when we need to rest again, we need to sleep again. It comes day after day, doesn't it? What a wonderful thing that God said, that's not enough. I want you to wake up one day to be wide awake and alive, never to die again. God's not interested in forever waking up the dead. He wants us to be alive with him for eternity. John chapter 11, verse 11, Jesus said to his disciples, We need to go see our friend Lazarus. He's asleep, and I need to awaken him. Well, Jesus wasn't just talking about waking someone up from sleep. He wanted to give him everlasting life. Well, we cherish all these experiences that we've shared with Sharon and with each other. And as we've been thinking about it, there's a lot of these experiences to reflect on and to remember. And I encourage you to do that If you read the guest book, if you read some of the pages in the guest book that you've signed, or maybe you're going to sign if you haven't had a chance to do that yet, read some of those. They talk about how we should continue to remember Sharon for the wonderful things from her life, and especially those things that we shared in. That, take out your flashcards that you have collected over the years. But remember this, the best one is yet to come. And that's the one where we will share in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If we have been united with him in a death like his, we will be united with him in a resurrection like his. Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead, never to die again, and he wants us to share in that with him. And one day, Jesus will say, I'm going to go and awaken Sharon. And you. And so we read from Colossians 3 in the first four verses. I want to repeat verse 4 as it's recorded in the King James Version. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. I'll trade a whole box of flashcards for that one. I hope that the faith that we know was in the heart of Sharon, and that is expressed so well in the songs that the family wanted us to sing with them today and to continue to sing with them today, and the scriptures that we've looked at, I pray that they will encourage you and give you a sense of peace and a sense of comfort. I want to remind you to stay for lunch while the family is away briefly for a private interment at Hillcrest, but we ask all of you to stay, please, and share in the lunch and to visit. If you're seated in the auditorium here, we ask you to go upstairs using the stairs at the front here by the glass doors and go down the hallway upstairs and turn in at the last door to your left, and there you will find your lunch. You can pick up your lunch and then distribute around the building. There's places to sit. It's warm outside if you want to wander outside with. But please stay and visit. Share your flashcards of Sharon, and let's do that. If you're in the balcony, you just join those who come upstairs and go down that hallway. If those of you in the annex who are hearing this, we'll ask them to come out from the annex and come and join you through the front doors, the glass doors, and upstairs and down the hallway. And hopefully that will work without a lot of congestion. There are a lot of people here today. Thank you for being here. Sharon taught us to share these things together. And so thank you for coming to do that today. As our service draws to a close in a moment, I'm going to ask one of our elders here, Garth Oberkirsch, to come, and he may have some thoughts and will lead us in a closing prayer. And then we're going to sing. So be prepared to sing When Peace Like a River and Praise God From Whom All Blessings Flow as we as we flow out of this room.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, it's very hard to say goodbye to our sister, but you know that already. It has been a comfort to hear our siblings and Lowell and John lead us in this memorial service. Father, we believe that it was your hand that blended the genetics of two great families some years ago with the Orrs and the Olsons. And we believe that this wonderful family was created because of you. As we think about Sharon's life, we know that she made an imprint in the education system, in the art world, in the music world, in the mission world. And we give you thanks for that. We pray that we can all try to honor the things that she held dear in our lives. We think about things that make this situation easier, but the thing that makes it easier is because you sent your son. We have the gift of eternal life. We have the anticipation of a heavenly home, and we look forward to someday being there with so many loved ones that we've had to say goodbye to. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We're going to sing When Peace Like a River. Let's start softly and we'll build towards the end of the second verse, and then the third verse will follow, of course.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. The clouds be rolled back.
God from whom